Genesis chapter 1, verse 16. This is the word of the Lord. Then God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. Amen. You may be seated in the very presence of our God. Then God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. I want to preach this morning as the Spirit shall guide with this thought in our minds, the lesson in lesser. The lesson in lesser. When one reads the narrative of creation, you can discover many principles that were established by God just in the manner in which he went about doing things in creation. For instance, one of the lessons that is quickly learned is that God is a God of order. Let the church say order. Right from the beginning of the Bible, you quickly discover that God is a God who refuses to function or operate without there being order. You discover that God refuses to operate without there being order. Theologians call what we see in the beginning the earth being without form, that is to say, without shape, and void, that is to be empty of substance. Theologians call that being without shape and being without substance chaos. Let the church say chaos. So that whenever you have something that has no shape, makes no sense, and has no substance, you are dealing with chaos. God refuses to operate or function within the context of chaos. Chaos is when you have something that has no shape, makes no sense, and has no substance. God refuses to operate in a condition and context where there is no substance and no sense. God will not bless chaos. God will not participate in chaos. Okay, let me give it to you again. Chaos is when you have something that has no shape, makes no sense, and has no substance. God refuses to function in or be a part of chaos. So maybe you need to make one of your resolutions for the new year, refusing to get mixed up, caught up, or involved in chaos. Because if God doesn't operate in chaos, I don't want to be in anything that God is not going to be a part of. Make this the year where you stay away from chaotic people. People who have no substance and make no sense. Stay away from chaotic situations, chaotic conditions, and chaotic relationships. As a matter of fact, you ought to right now, the first Sunday of 2010, declare your life a no chaos zone. Oh, okay, just touch somebody and tell them, this is a no chaos zone. Don't come at me with mess. Don't talk to me about stuff that doesn't have substance. Don't come to me with foolishness. Don't try to be my friend if you aren't going anywhere. Don't try to be all up in my life if you can't help me get where God wants me to be. This is a no chaos zone. Somebody say, no chaos. No chaos in my house, no chaos in my relationship. Why would you want people in your life who have no substance? And whose actions make no chaos on your job, no chaos in your church, because this is the year you want God to be a part of everything in your life. If I can't ask God to bless it, it's chaos. Now here's the good news revealed in creation. God, somebody might shout, has the power to step into chaos and turn it into cosmos. Okay, let me come back and get you one more time. Chaos is when there is no shape, no sense, no substance. Cosmos is when there is shape, sense, order, meaning, purpose, and substance. God's got a way of stepping into mess that makes no sense, speaking a word over the mess, and turning the mess into a miracle. Now, I don't see why all of us didn't shout, because if the truth be told, God didn't just do that to the chaos around us. God did that to the chaos that was in us, because all of us were a mess with no shape, and then Jesus stepped in and turned our life into order. Can I preach it like I feel it? God is so powerful, he can step into a chaotic situation and take all the pieces of the chaos, and by the time he is finished working in it, it will have meaning and purpose. That's why if your life today is in chaos, disarray, and mess, if you give it to God today, he's got the power to turn it into something wonderful. You don't need a new life. You just need to let God take over your life now. And he'll turn your... Is there anybody in here who can testify that I tried to fix it on my own and all I did was create more chaos? But now it's time to move out of the way and watch God do what only God is a God of order. Let the church say order. One of the other things we learn about God and life from creation is the necessity of connection for purposeful living. When you read the creation story, God connected everything and he made everything relate to everything. Now here's where the Lord got me. That he made water relate to fish, water relate to grass, grass relate to cows. He didn't just let grass relate to grass, water relate to water, fish relate to fish. For all of them to work purposefully, they had to be connected to something diverse. I'm preaching if y'all don't say nothing. That the power of connection is in the power of diversity. Real power comes when we all don't look alike, act alike, but connect all of our differences into diversity that makes power. This is going to shock some of y'all, might make some of y'all mad. I'm asking God, starting in 2010, to make Bethel a non-black church and make us a diverse church where all of us, black and white, doctors, y'all ain't talking to me in here, black, white, Latino, Indian, Chinese, Japanese, gutter, doctor, prostitute, professor, y'all ain't saying nothing to me. Because if we all work with our diversity, God will create a church that eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. Let the church say diversity. So as I was reading the story over again, something leaped out at me from that one verse I read to you. God is a God of purpose. He does everything with purpose in mind. When you read the verse that I read to you, implicit within it is the reality that God does not measure importance the way we do. Okay, listen to the verse. He created two great lights. Listen to the words. A greater light to rule the day, and a lesser light to rule the night. See, we measure importance by titles and money, degrees, in the church, longevity. I've been there 60 years. Who cares? I've been there 50 years. So what? God doesn't measure importance and value like we do. See, God gave me a revelation that messed me up. And I'm telling you, I don't know if you heard it before, but messed me up right now. The first method, I'm going somewhere with this. The first method the devil used in the Garden of Eden was the temptation of comparison. Stick with me. This is going to mess you up because it messed me up. He had Eve comparing herself to God. And the knowledge God had over against the knowledge she had. And she took the fruit because by comparison, she didn't measure up to God. So the devil said, by comparison, God knows if you eat that fruit, you'll be just as smart as him. So Eve started comparing her knowledge to God's knowledge and said, I don't compare, so if I want to be equal, I got to take the fruit. It's one of the tricks of the devil that still works. And I know it still works because jealousy and haters are alive and well. And the only reason those two things rear their ugly head is because we begin to get caught up in the temptation of comparison, and then we mix it with our own insecurity, and when we compare, we feel we don't measure up. Then we've got to tear down in order to feel important, or we do all we can to try to come up, so we fake up because we are caught up in comparing ourselves because of how society says importance and value is measured. And here's what Eve missed and what we miss. She couldn't compare because she was Eve and God was God. In other words, they were two totally different persons with two totally different functions. And since she did not have the functional responsibility God had, she would not need to have the knowledge God had. See, why are you around here comparing yourself to somebody when you are not them and they are not you? Not having what they have does not make you any less significant. Because kingdom significance does not come from what you have or what you are called or how well you are known, but significance comes from functioning in your purpose. So if we were the moon, the greater light, lesser light, if we were the moon, we'd have had issue with calling me lesser. what one was the sun and the other was the moon. Now to us, and in our measure of value and how we measure importance, yeah, y'all ain't gonna say it, but if you were the moon, you'd already be upset with God. How dare you call me the lesser? Because to us, lesser means not as important, insignificant, not as valuable, inferior, subordinate, weaker. It was called lesser because of its size, not because of its significance. As a matter of fact, if you read the verse again, you will discover that it said God made two great lights. Come back, y'all missing it. I know this seems like a crazy verse to preach, but come back. See, if you take your eyes off the word lesser and see the first description, it says that both lights were great. Yes, they were different in size, but they were the same in greatness because they both functioned where God decided for them to function. See, this is a word for somebody today who feels like or has been made to feel like because you have lesser, you are less significant. Because you have less money, or because you have less education, or because you're single and ain't married, or because you have a smaller job, or because you're driving a car that's 10 years old, or because you're living in your grandmama's house. I know some of y'all ain't gonna shout, because there are a whole lot of people in the body of Christ, with all your shouting, with all your smiling, with all your singing, you live with the demonic dysfunction of insecurity because you characterize yourself as being lesser than everybody else. But here is the shout. You may have lesser, but you can still be just as great when you stick to who you are and what God has purposed you to do. I wish you would turn and tell somebody, I'm just as great as anybody in this room. I don't have their degree. I may not have their money. I may not drive their car. I may have a criminal record. I may have been drunk. But when I decide to be who God made me, I'm just as great as anybody else in the room. And some young person in the balcony better hear me. You ain't got to give up what God gave you to be great. You ain't got to let him between your legs to be great. You ain't got to wear your pants beneath your waist to be great. You ain't got to have grills all up in your mouth to be great. You ain't got to cuss for a profession to be great. If you just be who God made you, you're already great. Tell your neighbor, I'm great. No, you didn't say it like that. Now, I know it sounds arrogant. Tell him, I'm great. Now, look back at him and tell him, and the reason I'm great is because I have a great God. And since he's in me and I'm in him, if he's great, call me Tony the Tiger. I'm great. Just quick, three quick things about the moon. Three quick things about the moon that relate to us. I believe the moon can teach us some things about how we are to operate. I believe it. Three quick things. Number one, the first thing I notice, watch this, about the moon is that it casts light on the earth in periods when the sun is absent. About 20 of y'all got that, yeah. That the moon casts light on the earth during the periods when the sun. Can I tell you that's one of your jobs as a believer? That when the Son left and ascended to sit at the right hand of the Father, he gave authority and duty to the church to be the light as he was the light. Now, it's finna get good now. If I'm the light, what that means is when you show up, dark darkness ought to go away. Okay, y'all not liking this one. Remember, darkness is associated with chaos, which means your presence ought to serve to bring an end to chaos. As a believer, you can't go into the darkness and stay in the darkness unless you start acting like darkness. If you are really light, then when you show up, whatever darkness was going on has got to flee when you show up in the room. That's why some folk on your job don't like you. Because when you walk in the room, they get uncomfortable gossiping and lying and cussing, and they just wish you'd leave. Tell them, I ain't leaving nowhere. Because when the sun left, he left me in charge to be the light. Can I preach it? Yeah, you can't go into the darkness as light, participating in what was going on when you showed up. See, when you show up, darkness has got to go. Because you come in with light. They ought not be comfortable cussing around you. Y'all ain't ready for this one today. They ought not be comfortable gossiping around you. They ought not be comfortable lying and starting rumors and tearing people's character down around you. I'm going to prove it to you. I'm going to prove it to you right from creation. Read Genesis 1 when you get a chance. I'm going to prove it to you. When you go back to the beginning of chapter 1, you see what the light did. When light showed up, it's right in text in the beginning of chapter 1. When light showed up, it revealed how messy things were. Preach, Bishop. The light revealed tossing waters, shoreless seas, land that was not above the sea. So the light exposed everything that needed to be fixed. When you show up, you ought to show up with such character, anointing, and presence that it reveals the dysfunction in the room. Let your light so shine. See, I know if I was preaching about a house and a car, everybody be running and shouting today. But I decided to start off 2010 with the admonition to us that if we're going to be the people of God, we got to start stepping into the darkness and telling the darkness, you can't stay here. Watch. Light exposes things that need to be fixed. If you are not making the situation better, and if you're not exposing what needs to be fixed, then you aren't functioning properly in your anointing. Now, let me help you understand before some of us, you know, and think we're too smart. Fixing don't mean fix it your way. Because I already know what some of y'all saying. That's what I'm doing. I'm fixing it. The devil is a liar. You don't fix it your way. The Bible says when the light revealed what was messed up, God is the one that fixed it. Too many of us try to play God instead of stepping out the way and letting God fix the situation. Now, just doing a little talking. The only way
the moon can shine is by reflecting the sun. Which means you won't necessarily shine just because you're called the moon. Unless you position yourself to be in the track of the sun so it can bounce off of you and give a reflection. What do you mean? Just because you call yourself a Christian does not mean you act like it. Because you can call yourself a Christian and be mean as hell, full of hell, raising hell, and causing hell. As a Christian, you ought to say, God, let me reflect your son. Let me reflect his glory. Let me reflect his love. Let me reflect his anointing. Let me reflect his power. I'm going to do the best I can. In astronomical terms, yes, the magnitude of the moon or the scale of brightness of the moon is very small. It's small. As a matter of fact, I discovered in doing research for the sermon that the brightness of the sun is 400 times as great as that of the moon. In other words, without the sun, ain't nothing to the moon. Y'all are missing your shot. See, I'm looking for somebody in here right now who's honest enough to say, I'm not somebody because I got a degree. I'm not somebody because I got a fancy house and a fancy car or a fancy title. Without the sun, I am nothing. I need about 10 of y'all. The old church used to sing a song, without him, I would be nothing. Without him, I'd surely fail. Without him, I would be drifting like a ship without a sail. Would you shake somebody's hand and tell them, without Jesus, I'm absolutely nothing. All right, let me move on. I'm almost done. So, the moon's purpose is to reflect light in the absence of the sun. You are the light of the world. You cannot be hid. You cannot go under a bushel. You can't go into darkness and darkness not go away. Because if you go into darkness and darkness don't go away, you're not being the light. Something else. The moon. That is, I like this one. And all the real folk gonna go with me on this. The moon can go from full to quarter to crescent to darkness. Oh, it's finna get good now. It's not always lit up at full capacity. Some days you see it better than other days. Some days you see it's light and it's darkness. Y'all ain't talking to me. Right? Ooh, y'all done got quiet right now. See, now I know I'm gonna lose some of the super saints, but there are days when I don't shine as brightly as I do on other days. Oh, I know I'm gonna lose some of y'all. There are some days when I'm full, where the Holy Ghost that's in me is on full. And I'm loving my enemies and praying for folk that use me, and I'm learning to do God's will. But then there are some days when I'm half, and if you catch the wrong side of me, I wish y'all would be honest with me in here today. There are some days, if you catch my dark side, am I talking to anybody? There are days, touch your neighbor and tell them, I got some dark areas still. See, y'all ain't trying to be real. Touch somebody else. Tell them, I've got some dark areas. I've got some weaknesses. I've got some proclivities and propensities. I've got some desires and some shortcomings. Woo, there are days when the cuss word come out and I didn't even know it. There are days when I feel like I need to get high to not lose my mind. There are days I feel like I need a swig of Chevy's Regal to keep from going off. There are days where I feel like calling her because I know she'll let me in more ways than one. Y'all can sit here and act stuck up if you want to, but you got to be honest enough to say, I got some dog signs. I ain't gonna sit up here and lie to y'all. Bishop got some. Some of y'all shouting because you done seen it. I ain't proud of it. I don't boast about it. I got some dog sides. Now the dog sides come out on the side that ain't close to the sun. See, when you got areas you trying to hold on to, y'all don't want to talk to me in here today. When you got areas you don't want to give to the sun, because as saved as you are, you still like it, those are areas that will remain dark. You got to give your dark area. That's why you got to be honest enough to admit where you're weak and who makes you weak and what makes you weak, so you can give it to Jesus. You walking around telling me, I can handle that by myself. The devil is a liar. Can I talk to you? I'm almost done. One of the problems some people have with church folk is that they see us trying to fake always being full when they've seen us at work being half. I get so tired of these holier than thou, sanctimonious, I don't ever mess up, I ain't never got no problems people who come to church with their noses stuck up in the air as if they're better than everybody else, when the reality is the only reason you don't do it no more is because you done got too old to do it. Done. Sometimes I'm on full, sometimes I'm on half, sometimes I get eclipsed. Come here. You do know when an eclipse happens, don't you? It's when the earth comes between the moon and the sun. See, when you let something come between you and your Savior, you are living in an eclipse state. And you better start 2010 saying, I ain't letting nothing or nobody come between me and my Savior. My boyfriend ain't that good. My girlfriend ain't that good. You ain't enough enemy for me to mess up my relationship with the Lord. Nothing will come between me. High five your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I'm not gonna be eclipsed. Now that was the wrong neighbor. Turn and tell somebody else, I will not be eclipsed. That was the wrong neighbor. Turn and tell somebody else, I don't care what comes in my life, I don't care what happens to me, I will not be eclipsed. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, angels, nor principalities, nor things present or things to come shall be able to separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. I love him too much to let anything eclipse me. Tell somebody, I love him too much. I got days. Oh, yeah. When I'm full, when I'm half. See, we think, y'all say, now give me 10 minutes. I know we got to do communion. We think. See, we've let this modern church fool us. We think sanctification and holiness is about being perfect. Are you, like my child says, really? Are you serious? That ain't what holiness and sanctification is. Because you can't be perfect. Holiness and sanctification is not about being perfect. It's about being better on the way to perfection. Come here. Y'all not saying nothing. Refuse to call myself sanctified because there's some stuff I still do. Sometimes I know I'm sanctified because I don't do it as often as I used to. Now here is this, I'm finna help somebody, and I promise you this is gonna tear this place up. Whether I'm full, whether I'm half, whether I'm crescent, or whether it's eclipsed, it's still the moon. You missed it. Even when I mess up, I'm still his child. I wish I had somebody could shout right through in here. Even on my dog days, because I'm still his child, if I confess my sin, he is faithful and just to forgive me and cleanse me. Is there anybody in here who can say I'm still God's child, even when I mess up, even when I don't do right, even when I'm in the dark, I'm still God's child. All right, I got to go. Just talking about the moon. Here's the last thing. Now, there may be more things the moon does, and if you come up with them, write that down and let that bless your life in your own meditation. But here's the last thing I got today. I'm not saying this all the moon does, but you know, I'm sure there's some other things, and this might prod and prompt your mind to think about those things. You ought to write them down and meditate on them. But here's the last one I've got for today. This messed me up. The moon exercises power over the seas by causing the changing of the tides. Y'all didn't get it. The moon makes the tide change. Y'all didn't get it. Yes. Every day, the moon pulls the waters of the ocean up along the shore and into the mouths of rivers. Now, as big as the ocean is, as powerful as the sea is, it has no power against the pull of the moon. Oh, God, help me preach it right through in here. See, the devil has got you convinced that some of the storms you're in are bigger than you. But can I tell you today, I don't care how high the waters get. I don't care how rough the seas get. You've got the power within you that even storms have got to behave when you start speaking.
Preaching them here today.
As enormous rocks, powerful as they are, they cause water, causes storms, it causes winds, but they have no power to resist the influence of the moon. You've got the power. Woo, over every storm. Oof. You got the power to be still in the storm. You've got the power to be at peace in the storm. You've got the power to walk in the storm. I wish I had some believers in here. And you've got the power to influence the tide. Y'all didn't get it. Y'all didn't get it. I told you the moon pulls. Yes. Which means you've got the power to pull some stuff down and pull some stuff up. Will you turn and tell your neighbor, this is the year when the tide turns in my favor. Y'all missed your shout right there. You had a rough year last year and things didn't go like you wanted them to go. But this is the year where the tide turns. Shake your neighbor's hand and tell your neighbor, this is my year, because I'm in charge of the tide. I can make the tides turn. I can make things go on my way. I can make things be blessed. Shake your neighbor's hand and tell them 2010, the tide is turning. Turning in my marriage. Turning in my finances. Turning in my ministry. Turning in my children. Turning in my body. Turning on my job. Turning in my friends. Is there anybody in here who can stand on your feet and say, I am the moon, and I declare today that I'm changing the tide. How do you change the tide? When you open up your mouth and start to give God praise. When you walk by faith and not by sight. When you learn to worship, He'll turn the tide. Is there anybody in here who can say, I'm ready for the tide to turn? I'm tired of crying. I'm tired of sleepless nights. I'm tired of trying to make ends meet. But this is my year to make things turn around. This is my year to make things be better. But I'm not gonna wait till the tide comes in. I'm gonna shout right now because the tide is coming in. Shake your neighbor and say, neighbor, you don't see it yet, but if you stay right here, the tide is coming in. High tide is coming. Your miracle is coming. Your breakthrough is coming. Your blessing is coming. Your favor is coming. If you believe it, say yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I wish I had somebody who can say, I'm ready for the turnaround in my life. I'm ready for God to turn it around. I'm ready for God to bless it. I came back to tell everybody in Bethel, this is the year when the tide comes in. Last year was hell. Had folk trying to kill us. Had bills we couldn't pay. Made decisions we wish we shouldn't have. Had folk trying to sue us. Had others trying to kill our character. Couldn't get what we wanted in a hotel. Couldn't get the hotel off the ground. All up in the newspaper. Folk lying on us. But this is the year when the tide turns around. I declare for this church that blessings and favor and increase and anointing and salvation and ministry is flowing through this house. If you're with me and if you're on my side, I know we don't normally vote, but are you ready for the question? If you are ready for the tide for Bethel to come all the way in, stand on your feet and say yes. Yes. Now look around who ain't standing, and you'll see who the culprits are. Look around who ain't standing, and you'll see who the enemies are. But if you're ready, say, I'm ready. I'm ready. And if it happens for Bethel, it's gonna happen for you. Down to the hill. This is the year. When the tide This is the year in your home. With your children, in your family, finances, in your health, in your ministry. This is the year when the tide turns around. This is the year. I declare this is the year when the struggle will be over. I'm just going to stand in faith and declare that this is the year where the struggle will be over. I don't care if the recession in Nova Zella, we're not going to struggle to pay bills. We're not going to struggle to do ministry. We're not going to struggle to be about the Lord's business. We're not going to struggle to love each other. We're not going to struggle to help each other. I declare in your house, you're not going to struggle to get your kids to do work. You're not going to struggle to get your kids to respect you. I declare upon your body, you're not going to struggle to get out of bed in the morning. This is the year when the tide turns and the struggle is over. That we stay so close to the sun that we become the light in darkness. I want to pray that this be the year that you let your light so shine that you get on the nerve of folk at your job. I want this to be the year where unspiritual folk get comfortable when you walk in the room. I want this to be the year where when they start dialing your number, they get disturbed and can't even finish dialing. Every head bowed. Let your light so shine. God, so often we come praying and asking you for stuff. And maybe one of the problems we have with modern Christianity is that we've been so busy getting stuff that we haven't gotten you. Maybe one of the struggles of modern Christianity is that we have relegated you to a genie. And when we rub on your lamp with our praise, we feel you're obligated to give us stuff. But God, in 2010, we want to give you more of us. We want our light to shine as a witness on our job and in our homes and in our church and in our family and in our friendship circles. We want darkness to be served notice that when we show up, it's got to flee. Help the anointing that is on us become an agent of exposition that exposes mess, that exposes things that aren't like you. Forgive us for claiming to be light but participating in darkness. Forgive us for claiming to be light but participating in chaos. And God, we make the commitment today that we don't want to be eclipsed. We don't want anything to be more important than you. Nothing to come between my soul and my Savior. Nothing to separate me from the love of God which is in you. So today, God, I pray for the anointing of our witness. I'm not praying for nobody to get a job. I'm not praying for nobody to get money or a house or married. I'm praying, oh God, today for the anointing of our witness. Our witness is not in what we drive. Our witness is not in how good we dress. Our witness is not in how much money we have in the bank, but our witness is in the way we live. Let our light so shine. And now, God, I pray for an anointing of salvation in this room. There are people in this room today I know that need your Son as their Savior. There are people in this room who have been participating in the darkness, and today they need to come into the marvelous light. There are people today that need to recognize that you sent your Son to die for their sins. And God, I'm praying right now a prayer of boldness upon every individual that needs it, that they not walk out of here today feeling good because they came to church on the first Sunday of the year, but make this Sunday a Sunday of transformation in their life. God, let the harvest come today in a way we've never seen it. Do it now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Looking for some inspirational gospel content? Just subscribe to Brother Rollins' YouTube channel today. We post the most motivational and preaching videos and gospel songs that are sure to get you through any situation. Even better, we have also launched a new apparel store that gives you access to a wide range of high-quality items. From awesome tees to hoodies, sweatshirts, mugs, and even tote bags, you can now proclaim your faith wherever you go and support our YouTube channel. Just visit the Brother Rollins YouTube channel and click on the store tab to shop now.